That was some kind of retaliation. And I knew that was coming.
So you knew it was coming. How did you feel challenging him? What would happen in those kinds of conversations?
Well, I think most married couples have points in life where they challenge each other about the direction that they should go. As a matter of fact, I felt rather strong in being able to say, I'm afraid for you, I don't want you to do this. And I'll get to the point. We reached a point in our marriage where I challenged Medgar about what he was doing. And he replied to me, either you are with me or you aren't. Mm. That's your decision to make. And I told him I'll let you know when I know what my decision is going to be. So for about a week, you know, there was some coolness there. We sat down and talked. I loved him dearly, and he loved me and his children. So there was no question about our parting ways. But how do we best accompany the needs of each other while serving the public as a whole, and particularly his people? So there was a compromise there, and it was a compromise every other day or so. It wasn't one solid thing. And so often, I have read in books and talked to people who romanticize the civil rights movement.
Right.
It was not all nice and easy and cozy and lovey-dovey. We had serious conversations, not only about issues, but about keeping family together and growing that family. And Medgar did a marvelous job in working with our children, telling them stories and where the safest place in the house was. And that's exactly what they did when that shot rang out that took Medgar's life.
He pulls up in the driveway, mm-hmm. and had you heard the car pull up?
Yes, and the children had as well. They were up late that night because they had watched, per their daddy's wishes, President Kennedy's address.
Okay.
So they were still up.
And then you expected him to come in, and then you hear the shot?
That's exactly what happened. But I do recall thinking, oh, my God, he came on the wrong street. He came in on the wrong street. The wrong street was the one that had lots of shrubbery and bushes. And you could tell the direction in which he was coming into the home. And he pulled into the driveway, got out with white T-shirts on a moonlit night. And the T-shirts say, Jim Crow must go. And then this powerful sound of the rifle. And our children did exactly what he taught them to do, fall to the floor and go to the safest place in the house, which they had determined was the bathroom and in the bathtub. I ran to the front door, screaming, opened the door. The force of the bullet had pushed him forward beyond my car. He had fallen and was strong enough to pull himself around the car with his keys in his hand. And that's what I saw. And that's what my children saw. And to this day, we were at Arlington Cemetery. There were tears, tears of sadness, wishing that Medgar had survived, but knowing full well that it was our duty and responsibility, as well as others, to carry the movement forward. And I certainly have felt that responsibility. And that's why I worked so hard for over 30 years to get the man who killed him to have him incarcerated.
And you have done that. You've also continued in the movement. You ended
yes,
up chairing the NAACP's board, and the world will remember you and your regal bearing at the president's second inauguration.
That's kind of you.
And what you've done is remarkable in your own right.
Well, thank you. It has not been easy. But doing the things that I have done helped to dismiss the hatred that I had. And I don't say that proudly. It's honest. I had a split personality there for a while. By day, I was a smiling, nice widow. And by night, I plotted and planned how to make the system bay. And the best way to do that was, as Medgar suggested, take on the arms of being a servant, of giving, of not expecting or demanding lots of kudos from the public, but feel it within your heart. And I felt it within my heart, and I have been so blessed to have explored and been a first in government and in business, whatnot. I've had a blessed life, and I'm very thankful for it. I still get angry, too. I saw an exhibit in Jackson, Mississippi, about Medgar, but it included the rifle that killed him. Mm. And it stopped me in the door as I looked upon this weapon of destruction. And I looked at the trigger, and I could just see Medgar's body lying there. But something miraculous happened. I saw something else. And that was in my imagination. I saw the fire that would come from that bullet. And to me, interestingly enough, it said peace and it said progress. So from being hurt, being angry, being vindictive, of having multiple personalities around all of it, of working so hard to see that justice prevailed in the killing of Medgar, to see that he was not forgotten, and that's been so important to me. We've come a long way in that. And 50 years later, I might be a little tired, might be a little weary, but I can't stop because there's too much at stake.
Well, I can say this 50 years later, Medgar was certainly chose the right woman to marry and bear his children. And all of us see that. And 50 years later, you've made sure this world did not forget Medgar Evers.
Thank you.
Mrs. Merle Evers Williams, thank you so much for your time.
My pleasure. My pleasure.